For the first 7 episodes of this series, we've built an understanding of explosions based almost exclusively on direct visual observations, using pictures like this one, a shot of Trinity 25 milliseconds after detonation. The technological prowess involved in such an image shouldn't be understated. It offers us an easy way to grasp the scale of the explosion, but it was far from easy to capture. The photographic description of the explosion from the growth of its radius has the great advantage of seeming immediate, mimicking the use of our own eye, the most prized of our ancestral tools to perceive the world around us. However, like the eye, the camera relies on the existence of a clear contrast between the object in focus and the background around it. On this picture, 25 milliseconds after detonation, the contrast is obvious, but a short while later, the explosion front is much more blurred. What we mean by the front becomes ambiguous. Multiple fronts can be considered. On this picture, Mac and his team actually describe 4 different fronts. The edge of the ball of fire, the dark front, the shock front, observed only by the distortion of the light it creates around the cable on the right. Finally, the 4th radius is that of the dust skirt on the ground. Beyond 100 milliseconds, optical measurements become increasingly challenging, especially for the shock front, which becomes transparent. Tracking the explosion must then rely on different kinds of eyes and contrast. All these data points were obtained by optical means by Mac and his team. But as we mentioned on several occasions already, the trajectory of the front in its late course can be tracked using pressure measurements, which are more akin to touch than vision. In order to explain how this is done in practice, this 8th and final episode will show how the domain of explosions can be represented from different perspectives, beyond that offered by tracking the growth of a size over time. Anticipating on future videos, we will see that the domain of explosions can be understood more intimately by going from kinematic to mechanical variables. Here, the explosion is shown from the perspective of a pair of kinematic variables, the size d and the time t since detonation. These variables have the advantage of being directly connected to 2 out of our 3 fundamental dimensions, that of length and that of time. But this choice of variables only reveals one aspect, one facet, of what an explosion is. Before we dive into the use of mechanical variables, combining all 3 dimensions of mass, length, and time, let's first discuss a few different kinematic perspectives. For Trinity, this plot represents the full domain of explosions, implied by considering 4 mechanical parameters: the energy E, the ejected mass M, the ambient density rho, and stress sigma. The 4 symbols between brackets can be understood as a sort of label, or title, for this plot. Once we know the values of these 4 parameters, we can draw all the lines and recover the great majority of the observed trajectory. Everything follows from an analysis of the dimensions of the mechanical quantities at play, that is, from dimensional analysis. This is assuming we know that the explosion is represented as a growing size over time, that the variables are known. We can recall these variables as indices on the set of 4 parameters. Rewrite the symbols D and T in pink to keep track of the fact that they are variables, in contrast to the 4 mechanical constants in black. More generally, the domain could be seen from a perspective involving other kinematic variables, K1 and K2, mixing time and space in different ways. For instance, we could decide to represent the explosion by plotting the speed of its front, V, versus the time since detonation, T. We've seen in previous episodes that from the radius curve, a few kinds of speeds can be defined. One possible speed is the average speed, which is simply the total distance traveled by the front over the time elapsed since detonation. The computation of this speed is simple. We just have to divide each radius by its associated time. A different kind of speed is the instantaneous speed of the front, the local derivative of the radius curve. To mitigate the noise produced by differentiation, it's best to first produce a smooth version of the radius curve and to compute the second speed from there. Here is a comparison of the 2 kinds of speeds, average and instantaneous, V1 and V2. We are still describing Trinity, but from a different perspective. How can we make sense of this, using what we know from the D versus T angle? First, at the beginning, the average and instantaneous speeds are equal to the constant initial speed, which is still a consequence of the interplay of energy and ejected mass. Later, after a few seconds, the much weaker shock front travels at the constant speed of sound, given by the balance of stress and density of the ambient air. Both speeds must be equal again. In between, the instantaneous and average speeds follow a similar slope, but with a slight offset between them. The regime followed by the average speed is easy to understand. The average speed is the ratio of d and t, and we know that in this time range the radius d follows the 2 over 5 power law. So the speed is a power law of time, with an exponent minus 3 over 5. And we know the prefactor k quite well from Taylor scaling. This regime is given by the interplay of energy and density. The dimensionless prefactor delta is the reduced Taylor set of constant, which is close to 1. Now, what about the trend followed by the instantaneous speed? The match with the straight line is not perfect, but the procedure we followed to compute this speed is not perfect either. So we won't dwell too much on the little bumps along the slope. We've seen already in previous episodes that since the instantaneous speed is the local derivative of the radius curve, we can estimate it from the power law followed by the radius in this range. This leads to a formula very close to the average speed. The instantaneous speed is here equal to 2/5 of the average speed. So in this time range, both speeds are a slightly different manifestation of the same regime, the energy density regime. Only the dimensionless prefactors vary a bit. Since on the initial and final regimes both speeds must be identical, there must be transition zones near the crossovers. Throughout this series, we've omitted the subtleties of these transitions, and we'll be guilty of the same neglect here. What we wish to discuss is how measurements of the speed of the explosion over time reveal the same interplay of the four mechanical quantities of the domain than when we used d as function of t. To that end, we can focus on the average speed, which comes directly from the data and does not require additional approximations. And we'll keep in mind that all kinds of spin aligned to the direction of propagation, average, instantaneous, and others, are expected to be proportional to d and inversely proportional to t. Alright then, we've got three regimes drawn, out of the six possible pairs of the domain. Where are the others? What about the trios of mechanical quantities and the associated remarkable points? Take the point of intersection on the top left. There, energy, density, and mass meet. This must be one of the special points, now seen not in the space-time plane, but in the speed-time plane. We expect a third regime to go through this point, the mass-density regime. But where is it exactly? The procedure to find the scaling of the speed for this regime is pretty straightforward. If the variables we're dealing with are d and t, the radius and the time, we've seen that matching the dimensions of the terms of this equation leads to the scaling for the length at the crossover between the initial regime and Taylor's regime. We had written this symbolically in this way, and we may add the variables as indices to keep in mind the perspective we're adopting on this regime. Now, if we change the variables, the procedure is the same. We match the dimensions to find the unknown exponent alpha, beta, and gamma. Note that if we already know the radius scaling, we can use it in the definition of the speed v to reach the same result. But this prior knowledge is not necessary. The evolution of the radius or of the speed are both direct consequences of dimensional analysis. Now that we have the speed regime associated with density and mass, we can draw it on our plot. A trend corresponding to a constant size looks like a line of slope minus 1 when represented as a speed versus time. We can follow the same method to draw the remaining two regimes and recover our four special points, each at the intersection of three lines. So this is how the domain of explosions look like when seen from the perspective of a speed over time. And if we compare it with our familiar domain, seen as the evolution of a radius, we see that the main features are conserved. The geometry of the domain changes, but not its topology. So although we spend most of this series describing explosions from the growth of a radius over time, we see that the mechanical constants of the domain also pave the possible trajectories when seen from different perspectives, as for the evolution of the front speed. Generally, we can choose to represent the domain for any pair of kinematic variables k1 and k2. If we neglect small numerical factors of order 1, the perspective on explosion offered by the variables k1 and k2 can be connected to the explosion radius d and time t since detonation. We've seen this with the front speed over time. Let's see another example. Let's consider the behavior of the speed at various distances from ground zero. For the distance to ground zero, we use the symbol d as for the radius, since the speed is here measured when the front passes at this distance. Here is the map of the area surrounding Trinity. This was not the case for this test, but imagine that stations had been placed at various distances from ground zero, with the capability of measuring the speed of the front as it passes through. The time of the measurement needs not be recorded, since as we will see, we can infer it from the distance of the station and the measured speed. The domain from this perspective takes a nice orthogonal shape. Here again, the topology is conserved. The data points are for Trinity, assuming V to be the average speed. The instantaneous speed would be slightly shifted down, as before. Then, if we make a measurement of the instantaneous speed at a given distance, within Taylor's range, we can estimate the time since detonation. And of course, we could reveal the mechanics behind the kinematics, and estimate the yield from this measurement. Despite changes in perspective, the subsets of the domain continue to structure the dynamics. In particular, the pairs of mechanical quantities lead to the six main regimes. We saw this from the perspective of the growth of a radius, and we've now seen the form these regimes take when seen from the perspective of speed versus time, or of a speed versus distance. And the beauty of it is that we do not need to remember these formulas, since they can be recovered easily from dimensional analysis, whenever we need them. The regimes stay relevant, and so do their intersections. Regardless of the type of kinematic perspective, we can use the points of intersection to define objective units, so as to construct dimensionless kinematic variables. Take speed versus time, as compared with size versus time, or most favored point of view. Here, the speed, the size, and the time are given in conventional units, and using the good old base 10. In the plot on the left as much as on the right, we can of course select one of the special points to define our units, like the Hopkinson-Krantz point. Note that the unit of speed, the Hopkinson-Krantz speed, is simply the sound speed. Now, from here, we know that there is only one last step to take to reach a fully objective representation. We need to use a base constructed from the dimensionless number built from the four mechanical quantities of the domain. The index gives the radix. Regardless of the choice of kinematic perspective, the objective units and base remain most relevant. We can show this on one other example, to underline that what we sometimes call variable in objective units, or dimensionless variables, are one and the same. This is the explosion domain as seen as an explosivity for different values of the front position. The units follow international standards, so they are combinations of meters and seconds. We first defined the explosivity in episode 3, such that it is constant during Taylor's regime. And so it is. We can then select one of the special points to build our units. For instance, we can take the Hopkinson-Krantz point. We know that the value of explosivity for this point is just the ratio of energy and density. And we know quite well now that the Hopkinson-Krantz size is the final blast radius. With these units, the two axes can be expressed in dimensionless form, which is just another way of saying that now the size is expressed in units of the final blast radius, and that the unit of explosivity is the ratio of energy and density. The dimensionless explosivity is what we had called N in episode 3, and grandly named the Taylor set of number. Despite variations in vocabulary here and there, the message remains the same. The four quantities of the domain gives the six regimes, four points where three regimes intersect, and we can use these points to construct objective units. Different choices in kinematic variables twist things a bit, but the topology of the template remains. This flexibility under changes of kinematic perspective is manifest in the index of the domain. In contrast to the Taylor set of number, or to any other kind of dimensionless variable, the index is independent of the kinematics. It does not depend on the radius of the explosion, nor on the time since detonation. It is independent of speed, explosivity, any variable. It only depends on the mechanical parameters, and so does the radix we can build from it. Just as with the other kinematic perspectives, this one is given most objectively by dropping base 10 and replacing it with R. Now that we've seen that the topology of the domain is unaltered by changes of kinematic variables, it is time to discuss how explosions look like when represented by mechanical variables. As example, we'll talk about the pressure variable. Here again, Trinity is a great example. Most of the data we've been using throughout this review came from this report by Julian Mack and his optical team. Los Alamos Report LA531. This was not the only report written on Trinity. It was the only report on optical measurements, on the films and photos taken on July 16, 1945. In parallel, there were many reports on various kinds of pressure measurements. LA352, sound velocity and excess velocity of the shockwave. 354, box gauge measurement of the blast pressure. 360, microbarograph pressure measurements. 366, blast measurement with condenser gauge. 431, measurement of maximum blast pressure near the center. In these contexts, just as well as in the case of optical measurements, Taylor's insights were omnipresent. For example, this is the introduction of one of the pressure reports. It was suggested by G.I. Taylor that maximum blast pressure should be recorded very near the center during the explosion of the atomic bomb at Trinity. Taylor also suggested that the pressures could be conveniently measured by crusher gauges. Crusher gauges, condenser gauges, piezo gauges, box gauges, maximum pressure gauges, mechanical impulse gauges, piston gauges, foil gauges, microbarographs. Many methods and tools were used to measure pressure at the Trinity test, and many more devices have been invented since. We won't get into the details since we also neglected a description of the many cameras used by the optical team. Let's start with the results from crusher gauges, which, as their name suggests, measure pressure in the way it crushes an object, usually a metallic cylinder. The authors measured pressure at five distances from ground zero. The vertical axis is the measured pressure. We use the symbol sigma because this pressure is a form of stress, just like the ambient pressure. However, in contrast to the ambient pressure, it is a variable, so we use the pink color and the little tile on the top to make sure not to confuse this variable with one of the four parameters of the domain. The most important is to recall the dimensions of pressure, or stress. It is what we will need to make sense of the measurements. The standard unit of pressure is the pascal, with 1 pascal equal to 1 kilogram per meter per second square. The horizontal axis is the front position. In practice, the measuring devices are located at fixed distances from ground zero, and the pressure is measured as the blast wave moves through, when the distance is equal to the front position. At a particular distance, some devices are able to measure the time series of the pressure. In this sketch, time and pressure are shown with a linear scale, with the origin corresponding to a pressure of zero, a vacuum. The baseline is the ambient pressure sigma, one of the four parameters of the domain. And the variable pressure we want to keep track of is the maximum pressure in this signal. It is a variable because if pressure is recorded further away, the front arrives later and the maximum pressure is lower. Note that in some cases the reported pressure is the difference with the baseline, which is sometimes called the overpressure or the peak pressure, especially in the reports on Trinity. Here we give the full pressure. Now that this is said, we can return to our crusher gauge's measurements. We know the ambient pressure is going to play a role, so let's extend the vertical scale so we can see it. The pressure around 100 meters from ground zero is many times greater than the atmospheric pressure. All the other pressure measurements we're going to talk about now were done further away, as far as 70 kilometers away, in the town of Nogol. So we'll need to extend the horizontal axis as well. Let's proceed from the nearest to the furthest measurement. These new points came from piston gauges. The same report also added one measurement from a mechanical impulse gauge. Additional points were contributed by a team measuring the pressure from excess velocity of the shockwave. Another team used foiled gauges. Using a condenser gauge, a single measurement was performed 6,000 yards from ground zero. The furthest measurements were done with microbarographs, recording pressures almost indistinguishable from the baseline on this log scale. Pulling all measurements together, the question now is how to interpret them using the four parameters of the domain. What is the shape of the domain when we're presented as a pressure versus distance? We already drew one regime, the one coming from the constant ambient pressure. Apparently, from this mechanical rather than kinematic perspective, regimes don't have to be given by pairs of mechanical parameters. One can be enough here to label the regime. What about the effects of the other three parameters? What is the trend followed by pressure, measured by the crusher and piston gauges, from 60 meters to a few hundred meters away from ground zero? Data suggests that the pressure in this range is inversely proportional to the cube of the distance. The loopy equals sign is here to remind us that this equation is not complete, since the dimensions of the pressure on the left do not match the dimensions on the right. A proper equation requires a mechanical factor, q. This factor is a constant, independent of the distance d. We can infer the dimensions of this constant from those of the pressure and distance, revealing that the mechanical quantity q must have the dimensions of an energy, so the same dimensions as the yield E of the explosion. Could it be that Q is just E? Not exactly. Just like the radius scalings, this pressure scaling must include a dimensionless prefactor, delta, not far from one. Here the data suggests that this constant prefactor is around a quarter. This value actually has a geometric interpretation, since the pressure during this regime of the explosion can be understood as a density of energy. As the explosion grows, the energy input is distributed over a larger volume, leading to a smaller pressure. Then, assuming a spherical blast, we can express the volume from the radius d, and so we have our prefactor delta, indeed close to a quarter. Now that we have a better grasp on the dimensionless prefactor, we can forget about it to focus on the essential. Yes, the scaling of the pressure does seem to be one of the regimes of the domain, as seen from this perspective, the one due to energy. Where do the two regimes intersect? At a particular length, and we know this length, it is the final blast radius, given by the ratio of energy and ambient pressure. The intersection between the three lines is the Hopkinson-Krantz point, now seen from a different perspective. If the transition between the energy scaling and the constant ambient pressure was sharp, then the crossover would occur exactly when the energy density equals the ambient pressure. However, in practice, the transition between the two consecutive regimes is smooth. The ambient pressure is only reached asymptotically. The final blast radius then admits a range of values, depending on the chosen threshold of overpressure. If the threshold of pressure is set around 2 atmospheres, so the overpressure is on the order of the background pressure, then the crossover length is very close to the ideal intersection. And indeed, when this length is measured for explosion with different yields, it is very close to the length built from the ratio of energy and ambient pressure. Here the prefactor is 0.75. This is basically what we had called D, capital D, in episode 4. The final blast radius. Back then, we could only roughly estimate the final radius from the extent of the dust cloud on the ground. But we now have a more objective criterion, based on pressure measurements. The pressure reached at the edge of this zone is just twice the atmospheric pressure. But it is quite enough. Experiencing one more atmosphere, almost instantaneously, is as if 10 meters of water had been dropped on you, destroying pretty much everything. We could also track the extent of smaller overpressures, yielding larger values of the impact radius. The red curve corresponds to a 30% increase of the pressure. But within this bound, most civilian buildings would still be destroyed. As in this footage from Operation Teapot. The orange curve corresponds to an overpressure of 6.9 kilopascals, that is 1 psi, about 7% of the background pressure. And yet, most windows under this pressure would be shattered. For Trinity, this would happen in a 5 kilometer radius from ground zero. This is the Graybull test, the one shot from a cannon, seen a couple of miles away. You can see the shock moves toward the camera. These three curves obtained from different thresholds of overpressure. They all follow the same scaling, but with different values of the prefactor, delta. To understand how this dimensionless prefactor depends on the overpressure would require a deeper understanding of the trajectory of the explosion near the Hopkinson-Krenz point, a subject that remains out of our scope on this series. We've learned a lot already on the light dynamics of explosion. Now, what about the early dynamics? The pressure rises and rises as we get closer to ground zero, but surely this rise must stop somewhere. We actually know the distance separating the early dynamics from Taylor's range. It is the length scale given by the ratio of ejected mass and density, while the swept up mass of the ambient medium becomes greater than the ejected mass. At this distance from ground zero, what would be the value of the pressure constructed from the energy density? First, it would be enormous, around 30 gigapascals, enough to obliterate most materials and to destroy any pressure gauge, hence the absence of data points there. We are here around 20 meters away from the center of the explosion. The tower on which the bomb was detonated was 30 meters high, so the ground itself was further away than the crossover. And yet, this is what was left of the tower, as seen in this historic picture of Professor Oppenheimer and General Groves, the two architects of the Manhattan Project. Side note, they are here standing at ground zero, just a few weeks after the explosion, only wearing overshoes, probably underestimating the remaining intensity of the radioactive fallout. Back to the pressure plot. So the pressure in the 20 meter radius was huge, but can we say more? Yes, indeed. We can evaluate the energy density at the crossover length to express this enormous pressure solely from the energy, the ejected mass, and the density of the ambient medium. From what we know from the kinematic perspectives on the explosion domain, we can probably guess the rest of the domain, the two additional spatial points, and the sixth regime. So the domain seen from this mechanical perspective seems to have a similar topology than the one seen from the kinematic perspectives. And of course, we can use one of the spatial points to construct objective units, and the index to select the appropriate radix. And as usual, we are sweeping under the rug details on how to handle the various dimensionless prefactors. So we have it, our first representation of the domain of explosions using a mechanical variable. The similarities with the kinematic perspective could incite us to think that not so much is new here. However, we should advise caution at this point, since the different scalings from this perspective are less systematically constructed than in the kinematic perspectives. we do not have a pair of mechanical parameters per regime. Here, some lines seem to be associated with just one mechanical parameter, some with two, and some with three. Things are less tidy than what we got used to. For instance, why don't density and mass have regimes of their own? Why does density even seem absent from the pressure scaling in Taylor's range? From the kinematic perspective, the dynamics of the explosion in this range were due to the opposing effects of energy and density. But here, things only seem to be due to energy. In fact, density is implicitly there. Let's go back to the dimensions to see more clearly what's going on. The four mechanical quantities of the domain, energy, density, stress, and mass, they're all mixture of the dimensions of mass, length, and time. What we wish is to construct different kinds of pressures, one for each parameter. We can do this by revealing the dimensions of pressure in each case. We can pause a moment to check that indeed, these algebraic manipulations have not changed the dimensions of the quantities. These stresses, between brackets, will be your variable pressures, one for each parameter, a priori different from one another. The indices on the different kinds of pressure recall the associated parameter. Since the explosion radius is a length, and the time since detonation is, well, a time, we can write these dimensional equations like that. So far, we cannot even be wrong. We're just playing with the algebra of dimensions. Then, let's put the pressures on the other side. Still, no way to be wrong. The third equation is flagrantly evident, but the others are no less tautological. And from these four tautologies, we can define four kinds of pressures. In one sweep, and from the authority of a definition, all the brackets have vanished. But note that even now, we cannot be wrong, since we are always free to define pressures or whatnot. The question is, are these pressures the ones we can measure with our devices? For two of these identities, we already know the answer. These pressures not only can be measured, but have been measured. We should really use approximate equalities to recall that there may be order 1 numerical factors here and there. Now, what about the pressure built from the ambient density? Rearranging, we can reveal the speed of the front. And this kind of pressure is actually pretty famous. It is often called the ram pressure, or the dynamic pressure. It is the pressure associated with motion at speed v in a medium of density rho. Shouldn't this be relevant to explosions? We have enough data on Trinity to answer this question. Let's go back to max data on the blast radius. For each data point, we have a radius d and a time t. So let's do this naively first and use the definition of the density-dependent stress we started with. We know it's not far from the traditional dynamic pressure. For each data point, we can compute this stress and plot it next to the bona fide pressure measurements. And well, this pressure does not seem too far off from what was measured with the pressure gauges. There is a constant offset, which we know we can deal with by introducing a dimensionless delta in the definition of the pressure. A good match is found for delta around a quarter. And if we want to use the instantaneous speed, V2, we know its relation with the average speed in Taylor's range, and we can similarly have a dimensionless coefficient close to 1. So here it is. The dynamic pressure is clearly relevant. More than this, for Taylor's range, the dynamic pressure seems to be identical to the energy density. And yes, indeed, the equality is even one way to understand Taylor's regime as a balance of pressures. Taylor's regime corresponds to the part of the dynamics, while the dynamic pressure on the left is equal to the energy density on the right. We know the speed v is not far from d over t. Then, moving things around, we get something we know quite well, Taylor's regime. We're always free to rearrange the terms of this equation to express it as equalities on different kinds of kinematic or mechanical variables. Taylor's regime is equivalent to the equation between two different kinds of pressure. But we could also write it as an equation between two forces if we wanted to. The left-hand side is the force depending on the ambient density and the variable d and t, and the right-hand side is the force depending on the energy and d. Here, the time does not appear explicitly. You can check that indeed, both sides have the dimension of a force. A force is an energy over a distance, as in the right-hand side, and it is also a mass times an acceleration. This representation of Taylor's regime pays tribute to the historical Newtonian formulation of mechanics. The mass of swept-up ambient air, multiplied by the acceleration of the front, is equal to the force based on the energy of the explosion. M times A is equal to F, which is more often written the other way around, F equals MA. Just another way to think about Taylor's regime. Returning to the different kinds of pressure, we understand now that Taylor's regime corresponds to the range of the explosion when the first two kinds of pressures are equal. Equating the energy base pressure and the density base pressure gives, well, the energy density regime. Pair the dynamic pressure with the ambient atmosphere, and you get the propagation of sound. You can easily imagine that the six pairs of pressures lead to the six regimes. These four identities are just ways to disguise the four parameters of the domain, such that they look like pressures. That's particularly useful in this context, since we indeed have ways to measure the pressure. It is thanks to this connection between mechanical and kinematic variables that we can use the data on the radius by Mack and Taylor to compute a dynamic pressure which fits well with the pressure measurements. So the radius measurements can be used to complement the pressure measurements. The radius over time perspective can be translated into a pressure over distance. And this translation works both ways. We can use the pressure measurements to complement the radius measurements. In particular, near the Hopkinson-Krenz point, the shock can be tracked by pressure measurements, although it is invisible to the eye. Since the trajectory of the explosion during Taylor's regime and during the regime of propagation at sound speed both involves the dynamic pressure, we can probably safely assume that the measured pressure in between can be expressed as a dynamic pressure. And if the measured pressure is the dynamic pressure, then there is a relationship between the variables sigma, d, and t, so we can express the time since detonation solely for more knowledge of the pressure at various distances from ground zero. If we assume this identity to be exact, then the pressure measurement seen on the radius curve would look like that, in magenta. Here again the two curves are slightly shifted, due to the slight difference between the instantaneous and average speeds, while the proportionality coefficient alpha comes from the exponent of the relationships between the time and radius. During Taylor's regime, we know that this exponent is 2 over 5. However, at very long time, the front moves at the speed of sound, and the exponent is 1. In between, the exponent alpha must vary to go from 2 over 5 to 1. The precise transformation between the pressure versus distance perspective and the radius versus time perspective requires knowledge of this variation of alpha. As mentioned before, this is out of our scope, but if we assume a reasonably smooth function going between 2 over 5 and 1 around the Hopkinson-Krenz point, then we obtain the extended trajectory of the front we've been dealing with since episode 4. Well, this is it. Regardless of the perspective, it is the interplay of the dimensions of the parameters that govern the dynamics. Whether we represent the dynamics from the growth of a radius, or from the evolution of the front speed, or the speed of the front at various distances from ground zero, or from the pressure at these distances. Different perspectives, same physics. From all perspectives, the domain looks like a parallelogram, with Taylor's regime as one of the two diagonals. The topology of the domain seems invariant under changes in perspective. Whether this is actually true for any choice of kinematic or mechanical variables will have to remain unanswered for now. To investigate this question fully would anticipate too much on videos beyond this series focused on explosions. we've said what we wanted to say about the explosion domain. Enough for you to now appreciate that these four symbols really encompass the main features of what happens in an explosion, large or small. In addition, you now understand that the method we use to study explosions is not at all restricted to them. We've seen what these four symbols can produce, so the next question, of course, is what happens if we consider different choices of mechanical parameters. Our next stop will be the droplet domain, where we will be discussing the spreading, coalescing and pinching of droplets under the influence of surface tension, density, viscosity, and the force associated with the conservation of volume. We will see many similarities with the physics of explosions, although the topology of this new domain will be different. The different kinds of topology that domains can exhibit will be discussed more systematically in the general series on mechanics, where we will eventually wonder about the dynamics associated with more than four mechanical parameters. Subtle is the relationship between matter, space, and time. With this introductory series, we hope to have conveyed that the mysterious interactions between this trinity of fundamental dimensions can be approached quite successfully by a dimensional analysis structured around the now classical duo formed by mechanics and kinematics. It will take many more videos to more deeply appreciate this kinship. Mechanic and kinematic. These two words have ancient-sounding Greek etymologies, but their use in physics is not that old. Mechanics, as the study of motion under the influence of forces and constraints, dates back to the 17th century, to Newton's time. Mechanic, machine, magic, may, might, mighty, from the Proto-Indo-European root mag, to be able, to have power, magnanimous. Kinematics, as the study of motion without explicit mention of the forces at play, is an even more recent term, coined by Ampère in the first half of the 19th century. Hairstyle had changed a bit in the meantime. Kinesis is the Greek for motion, movement, also from ancient Proto-Indo-European origins. In this series on explosions, we've seen that the relationship between mechanics and kinematics is asymmetric. The mechanics imply the kinematics. The mechanical parameters of the domain set the path followed by the explosions, produce turning points that can be used as origins to measure motion in objective units, and even provide an objective radix to replace the subjective base 10. In contrast, the kinematics more loosely constrain the mechanics. Taylor could only infer the yield of trinity because he assumed that the energy should be faced with the ambient density. In other words, he obtained the energy from the kinematics and from the density, one of the mechanical parameters. This asymmetry between kinematics and mechanics can be understood as a consequence of an underlying hierarchy, the kinematic being a special subset of the mechanic. On this channel, we say that a quantity is mechanical when its dimensions are a mixture of mass, space, and time. In contrast, we said a quantity is kinematic when its dimensions are a mixture of space and time only. So the exponent z for a kinematic quantity is just zero. Who can do more can do less. The relationship between the mechanic and kinematic is similar to the relationship between the kinematic and the geometric, that which pertains to space only. The mechanic can influence the kinematic in setting the regimes of the dynamics. The mechanic can influence the geometric in the characteristic length of the spatial points. What we also showed, and which is more innovative, is that the mechanic also influences the arithmetic. The mechanical parameters combine to produce a number, the number of the domain, the objective radix. Galileo famously said that the laws of nature are written in the language of mathematics. What we've seen with the example of explosions is that the mechanics at play in a particular situation shape the number base itself. This suggests the appropriate math to be used. So maybe the laws of mathematics are written in the language of physics, which, by the way, is just an old Greek word for nature. So the index of the explosion domain is just one of nature's numbers.
Meet again. Don't know where. Don't know when. But I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Just.